Well, good morning, everybody. Let's stand to our feet, and I want to read just a section from the book of Isaiah, and then I'm going to pray, and we're going to worship the Lord. And you have a treat in store for you this morning. We have a movement original that we're going to be singing during the first worship set, written by Stuart. Come on, can we give him a pre-round of applause before anything else? All right, I just want to read this section from Isaiah 9. For unto us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and of his peace there will be no end. On the throne of David and over his kingdom to establish it and uphold it with justice and with righteousness from this time forth and forevermore, the zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this. Father God, we thank you that this Christmas, Lord, we get to celebrate that unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and his name is Jesus. He's the hope of the world. He's the light of the world. He came and lived and died and rose from the dead so that we could be forgiven, so that we could have eternal life. And there's infinite hope in Jesus, the light of the world. Jesus, we worship you in this room this morning. We celebrate you in this room this morning. Fill this room with your presence. And I pray that everything we do this morning gives glory and honor to you. We love you, Jesus. And we want to minister to you. We want to bless you this morning as we sing to you. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
Hey, Boobie family, how y'all doing?
Good.
All right. Let's give Jesus a shout of praise right now. Let's just applaud him. Let's just call out his name, Jesus. How we love you. How we love you, Lord. Your joy has pierced through the darkness of this world and given us a season like no other, God. And Lord, we celebrate you this morning.
Joyous streams. Oh, 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 oh. I'm not held by my own Out of my own way. So I'm getting out of my own way. I'm getting out of my own way. I'm getting out of my own way. So I praise you, Lord, you saved me and you raised me. So I praise you, I'm so thankful. Lord, you saved me and you raised me. So I praise you, I'm so thankful. Lord, you saved me and you raised me. So I praise you, I'm so thankful. Lord, you saved me and you raised me. So I praise you, I'm so thankful. Lord, you saved me and you raised me, so I praise you, I'm so thankful. Lord, you saved me and you raised me, so I praise you, I'm so thankful. Lord, you saved me and you raised me, so I praise you, I'm so thankful. Lord, you saved me and you raised me, so I praise you, I'm so thankful. Lord, you saved me and you raised me, so I praise you. Smell like wax in your presence, and I can't find the words to describe your goodness. Oh, I'm getting out of my own way. I'm getting out of my own way. You've given us the gift of your forgiveness. You've given me the gift of your forgiveness. I'm
I know I'm quoting the song, but like, we got to get out of our own way to let Jesus in, to let God work in us, you know? It's sometimes our way is good because sometimes God tells us what our way is. And, you know, sometimes we struggle a little bit with listening to the Lord. The whole point of that whole song is, it's, man, God's powerful. God's really powerful. You know, I don't want to talk too much, but there was a sermon months ago, like in the beginning of summer, Mike was talking about the apostles on the boat. Jesus taking a nap. Storm's going crazy. Everybody's going, Jesus, we are in trouble, you know? And Jesus goes, no, we're not. And they're like, dude, don't you see these crazy waves? Don't you see, like, this is dangerous. Like, we gotta go back in. Jesus goes, guys, let me do this thing, okay? And he does this thing, and he's like, hey, waves, be quiet. And the waves listen. And up until that point, and this is the first time I'd heard this when Mike preached about this a couple months ago, but up until that point, they'd only known Jesus as this guy going around healing people, this guy healing the sick, and like, he's a rabbi, he's a teacher. They didn't realize that, like, the earth bows down, you know? And to have that understanding that the earth bows down to the Lord, that even the rocks cry out, to then want to, like, follow our own path is, like, a little silly. So yeah, just take this as some encouragement for you. God's got your best interest in mind, so follow him.
By the way, that song is a Movement original and Stuart wrote it. Can we just give Stuart a big round of applause?
I'm
Jesus, we worship you in this room this morning. I pray for every single person in this room. I pray for a fresh filling of your Holy Spirit for them this morning. Will you just take a moment, if you feel comfortable, just put your hands out in front of you and just ask God to fill you afresh with his Holy Spirit this morning. Just say, Father, fill me with your Holy Spirit. Just breathe in the Spirit of God this morning. Say, God, fill me with your Holy Spirit. And Jesus, we worship you in this room this morning. I pray, Lord, you bring healing to every heart, healing to every mind, that you would break every bondage, every addiction, every chain, every bit of fear or worry or concern. I pray that, Jesus, you'd set every single person free this morning in this room, Lord. I pray that all of us would put on the helmet of salvation this morning and that, Lord, you would guard our thoughts and our minds. We thank you, Lord, that no matter how dark the world is or how dark the world becomes, that, Jesus, you are the light of the world. We thank you that you are the flawless one, you're the perfect one, you're the rock, you're our firm foundation. And when everything around us is changing and when it's all chaotic around us, as the band sung, you are the rock, you are the sure thing, you are the foundation. So we worship you, Jesus. Come on, let's just sing the last part of that song with you one more time and let's lift our hands, let's sing to Jesus. Let's take our eyes off of everything else and let's just put our eyes on Jesus Christ this morning in this place. Come on, let's correct our vision. Let's put on our Holy Spirit reading glasses and let's put our eyes back on Jesus, back on the light of the world, back on our hope. Come on, let's just sing that last part through one more time. Come on, let's give Jesus a round of applause. Let's put our hands together for the Lord this morning. All right, take 2 minutes. Say hi to somebody new. Try to make a new connection this morning. Make some friends. Give somebody a hug. Take 2 minutes. Get to know somebody.
Sunday, everybody. Welcome to the 12 o'clock service. So just a few short announcements today. First of all, thank you all for being here. So first announcement is that next Sunday, the Christmas Eve service will be a virtual service. So we won't be here present. You can find it on YouTube or on our website. There's links available there. Our next in-person service will be New Year's Eve. So we'll have our New Year's Eve service here, but then New Year's Eve night, there will be a New Year's Eve worship service, which is very exciting. It'll be from 11 p.m. to 12:30 a.m., so we'll be ringing in the new year, praising and worshiping the Lord and asking for his blessings and his grace in this new year. And it will be at the prayer chapel at 4 Rutherford Place. So please do not show up here and expect us all to be waiting for you. 4 Rutherford Place. So we hope to see you all there. If you are in need of prayer, there are prayer ministry team members available after the service to pray for you. Please, please, please do not hesitate to go and ask for prayer. We love you. We want to pray for you for any circumstance that you're going through right now. If you're a little bit nervous about going and asking for prayer, I know I can be sometimes, we have prayer cards that are available for you on the resources table. You can fill out, you can do it anonymously, you can write your name on there, and then you can place them in the prayer card box on the resources table, and our prayer team will be more than happy to pray over those requests. If you would like to volunteer in any capacity, we would be more than happy to have you on any one of our teams. In the pamphlets on your seat are volunteer cards. You can fill them out and then place them in the tithes and offerings box on the resource table, and then someone from the volunteer teams will contact you. Giving, we have many ways for you to give. They're all on the projection on either side of me over here. We just ask that you do give intentionally. If you're gonna do recurring giving, just know when that money is going to be coming out of your account so that you can pray over it and really pray for the intentions of those funds. So I'm just gonna pray really quickly and then we'll introduce Pastor Mike. Heavenly Father, I just thank you for another Sunday in your house, Lord. I thank you for the fellowship and the community in this space. I thank you for Pastor Mike. I thank you for our incredible worship team that you have blessed with the talents to lead us and in prayer and worship and just the write these songs to glorify you, Lord. I thank you for this new year that we're going into, and that we ask for more of your presence. We want more of you, Jesus, continuously more of you. I thank you for the message that you're going to give us through Pastor Mike, and I pray that they are your words, not his, Jesus. In your name, amen.
Come on, let's give Lyric a round of applause for doing announcements this morning. It's a big day today. We need to pray that the Jets beat the Dolphins and that the Buffalo Bills beat the Dallas Cowboys. Can I get an amen on that? Now, you see that, you feel the negativity in the room? It's because half our church is from Texas, and so I feel deeply personally conflicted about this right now. So, and I have, and I'm rooting for Zach Wilson. I'm believing in Zach Wilson. One of our brothers in the first service says, "I don't believe in Zach Wilson." Also, the Christmas party went really great Thursday night. Come on, give the Lord a round of applause. I think 2/3 of the people there were people that I've never met before, so it was wonderful to meet a lot of new people. Also, Izzy did an outstanding job with all the food. It looked like something from Better Homes and Garden. Can we give Izzy a round of applause for doing such a great job with the food? We had a gingerbread house-making contest. It was hyper-competitive, but we had a winner, and then Mary, she was here in the first service. She won the bake-off. So, and again, just to reiterate, we're not going to be here next Sunday. We'll be online, and so you can stay home and watch church from the comfort of your bed and your pajama bottoms or whatever. And then also, I really do encourage everybody to come out. We've never done it before. We've never prayed and worshiped in the New Year's Eve. And so we're really excited to do that, and Roth has been really fired up about it, and miraculously, we were able to get that prayer chapel. They normally don't make it available that late at night, but they're making an exception for us. And I really think 2024 is going to be an outstanding year in the life of our church. I really do. There's some things that are in the works that, you know, we'll let you guys know more about as they kind of come into shape. But I actually think it's the Lord that we're going to begin the brand new year worshiping and praying in the new year. And so I know there's a lot of things you could do on a New Year's Eve, but I just, you know, I challenge you. It's like maybe this New Year's Eve, come join us as we pray and worship in the new year. And also, I really want to try to promote it well and really try to open it up to the whole church of New York City. I think there's probably a lot of Christians throughout the five boroughs that would love to actually pray and worship in the New Year's Eve. So hopefully, we, you know, a lot of folks will come and join us and it'll be a powerful night. Well, on Sunday mornings, what I want to do this Sunday and next Sunday is I want to do a short two-week Advent series. Normally, Advent series are 4 weeks, but we're not doing that. We're doing a two-week Advent series, so. And the title for this Advent series is God Became Human. And I'm going to talk about it next Sunday in the online message is that, you know, there's a really important theological concept at the heart of Christmas that sometimes we don't think about or we take for granted. And the big theological word is called the incarnation. Just say that. Just say incarnation. And what that means is that in Jesus, God became a human being. And I think that is so profound, is that at the heart of Christianity, at the center of Christianity, is this powerful, beautiful fact that in Jesus, God became human. And so because God became human, Jesus is the sympathetic God. That the God of Christianity is this deeply empathetic God, and he's actually beyond that. He's this sympathetic God. And so as you come to church on the Sunday morning, or if you come out New Year's Eve, as you approach the Christian God, what I want you to visualize in your mind is that you're actually approaching a God of tremendous sympathy. We don't have to hold back. We don't have to, you know, not engage. We don't have to hide from this God because he's a deeply sympathetic God. And so we can draw near to the throne of grace to find grace and help in our time of need. And that's what we're going to see in our passage today. And to be a little perfectly honest, this message is going to be a little Bible nerdy. Is that okay? I think I put the first service to sleep a little bit, so I'm going to try to not make it super Bible nerdy, but it will be a little bit Bible nerdy, and I think you'll find it meaningful and helpful. But the title for today's message is The Sympathetic God, and the passage I want to look at is Hebrews chapter 4, verses 14 through 16. And actually, I want you just to read this along with me. Let's read it out loud together. Since then, we have a great high priest. Actually, let me read this. I have a different thing in my notes. Okay, yeah, okay. Therefore, since we have a great high priest who has ascended into heaven, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold firmly to the faith we profess. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but we have one who has been tempted in every way, just as we are, yet he did not sin. Let us then approach God's throne of grace with confidence so that we may receive grace and mercy. So we might find mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need. I apologize. I'm so sorry. I've had a tough couple weeks, so I'm not at 100% today. Let's pray, and we'll take a few minutes to unpack this. Father God, we thank you for your word. We thank you that the word of God is living and active and sharper than any two-edged sword, and I thank you for the truth. And Jesus, you are so amazing. You're the most amazing thing. You're so incredible, Lord. And I pray that that would be the big takeaway this morning for everybody in this room is that, Jesus, you're amazing, that you're for us, that you're our high priest, and that you are so sympathetic, Lord. That when we look out on the universe, we're not looking out on a merciless God or a cold God or an emotionally distant God, but we're looking out at a God who loves us more than we could possibly imagine. And that's what I pray that everybody in this room would walk away with this morning is how amazing you are, Jesus. How sympathetic you are, and that we can draw near to you and find everything we need in our times of difficulty. So bless this time now, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Now, the Bible has two main sections to it, okay? The Bible, it's one book, but it's really a library of books. It's 66 books written by 40 different authors over about a 2,000-year period of time. The Old Testament has 39 books, and the New Testament has 27 books. And one of the books in the New Testament is a book called Hebrews. And Hebrews is a very interesting book because we actually have no idea who wrote the book of Hebrews. It doesn't have a greeting. It doesn't begin with the title of the author. And so we don't know who wrote the book of Hebrews. Down through church history, a lot of, you know, New Testament scholars thought the Apostle Paul wrote the book of Hebrews. I don't think Paul wrote the book of Hebrews. A lot of modern scholarship doesn't think he wrote the book of Hebrews. Some people think that maybe Barnabas wrote it. And Barnabas was a Levite who became a Christian. He was a member of the early church. He was a ministry companion of the Apostle Paul. Barnabas might have wrote it. There's another young Christian named Apollos, who was an Alexandrian Jew who became a Christian like in the early church, and he was this gifted evangelist. Maybe Apollos wrote it. I actually think Apollos wrote it. Martin Luther thought that he did. But we don't know who wrote the book of Hebrews. But Hebrews was written to a community of early Jewish Christians who were experiencing persecution for following Jesus. And because it was so hard to follow Jesus, and they were experiencing so much opposition for following Jesus, they were actually tempted just to throw in the towel and just go back to their old way of life. They were tempted just to go back to the temple, go back to the synagogue, maybe they want to commit suicide, I don't know, and just go back to what was familiar and just go back within the fold of Judaism. And so the author of Hebrews is encouraging them not to go back to the old covenant because Jesus is greater than the old covenant. And really, if you're going to give the book of Hebrews like one simple title, it's that Jesus is greater. Amen? Amen? And Jesus is greater than everything. He's greater than everything in life. You know, I say this all the time, and I believe it, is that the greatest thing in New York City is Jesus Christ. Come on, can I get an amen on that? Amen. There's nothing greater than Jesus. I've really been thinking about this. Like, I was thinking about it yesterday. Like, I like the best things in life, okay? I like the finer things in life. I like... You know, I'm middle class, but I have wealthy taste. Can I get an amen from anybody? Like, and I get myself in trouble sometimes because I try to live beyond my means. Am I the only person? No, you guys left me up here on my own. You do that too, okay? But that's partly why I live in New York City, because I love the best things. I want to go to the best cities. I want to see the best art. I want to eat the best food. Like, I just like the best things in life. And I was thinking about it yesterday. It's like, and partly why I became a Christian, and really the reason I became a Christian, is because Jesus is the best thing in life. He literally is the best thing in life. And I was just in my bedroom, and I was throwing something into my hamper. Why that came to my mind, I don't know, but that's what I was thinking about, is Jesus is the best thing in life. And I feel so privileged that I came to know Jesus. And surfing is awesome. But Jesus is better than surfing. But Jesus is greater. And for this particular group of people, what he's going to do is he's going to point back to the old covenant. He's going to point back to the way you knew Yahweh before Jesus came. And he's saying, Jesus is greater than all of that. He's greater than the old covenant. He's greater than the prophets. He's greater than the angels. He's greater than Moses. He's greater than the temple and the priesthood and the law and the sacrificial system. He's greater than the Torah. And that as our new high priest, because even as Christians, we have a high priest. Because even though he was divine, which makes him a superior high priest than the high priest of the old covenant, he was also human. He's the special high priest. He's the spectacular high priest that he's divine. He's God. And so that makes him the greatest high priest of all. But yet he's also human. And so because he's human, he can sympathize with us. He can be this wonderful, tender, kind, gentle high priest. Because he, even though he's God, knows what it's like to be a human being because he was a human being. And so there's three things that I want us to see in this passage, and then there's two applications I want to make from it. Jesus is a superior high priest. Jesus is both a divine and a human high priest. And Jesus is a sympathetic high priest. And because of these three characteristics, the author of Hebrews is going to say, because of this, we're to hold on to our faith and we're to draw near to the throne of grace with confidence. And I'll just interject one thing, too, is, you know, we really value worship at our church. And can we just give our worship team a round of applause? And if you're not used to that, or you're a man, so you're like, I don't worship because I'm a dude. I want to challenge you to learn to love worship, to lean into worship. God inhabits the praises of his people. And as you worship God, you actually encounter God. That's why worship, probably it's all about the same category, but that's why worshiping Jesus is literally one of my favorite things on planet Earth. And the most amazing experiences I've had in life more than anything else were actually Holy Spirit moments in the midst of worship. And so I want to challenge all of you to lean into worship. And men to just, you know, figure it out, all right? Lift your hands, sing the songs, press in. You know, the book of Psalms is the hymn book of the Bible, and two-thirds of the Psalms were written by King David. And David was like a combination of like, I don't know, like Steve Jobs and The Rock. I mean, he was like this special forces Delta operator guy who could kill everybody but loved God and wrote songs, and he was the most amazing guy. And so as a man, you're like, well, that's not tough. Well, David was super tough, and he wrote, you know, 2/3 of the songs in the Bible. Amen? All right, enough of that. So I want to just challenge you to lean in and worship. But we're to hold on to our faith, and we're to draw near to the throne of grace with confidence. And what you're going to see this morning is you can always go to the throne of grace. Because sometimes we think, well, Mike, I can't worship because you don't know what I did this week. You don't know what I did last night. You don't know what the last month has been like in my life. I don't feel worthy. I don't feel clean. I don't feel like I can draw near to God. Well, I want to just shatter that whole concept this morning. And I want you to see that God's throne is a throne of grace. That actually, the place you don't avoid when you're not at a good place is the throne of grace. That's actually the exact place you should go to. You know, if you're sick, you don't not go to the hospital, you go to the hospital, amen? Amen. If you're in an emergency, you go to the emergency room. You don't go, no, I don't want to go to the emergency room because I'm just not worthy. No, you go to the emergency room. Go. You're like bleeding out. No, I just don't feel worthy to go. If you're that person's friend, ignore them and take them to the emergency room, amen? So when we feel bad, when we feel like we can't draw near to God, that's when we actually need to draw near to God the most. And we need to receive that cleansing, that healing, and that renewal, and that restoration that comes from the throne of grace. So that's what I hope you see this morning. I want to show you something a little bit, and I really hope it helps you. So let's walk through this, right? A little Bible nerdy, but hang with me, okay? So the first thing we see is that Jesus is a superior high priest. Now, in the Old Testament, you had what was called in Hebrew the Kohen Gadol, okay? And what the Kohen Gadol was is he was the chief priest or the high priest. So in the Jerusalem of Jesus' day, you had the temple, and then within the temple, you had this whole priesthood. And the responsibility of the priest was to offer sacrifices on behalf of the people of Israel. So before Jesus came, if you wanted to worship God, you didn't go to a basement at 23rd and Broadway. You went up to this building in Jerusalem, and you would go up and you would literally offer a sacrifice. Like, that's how you worship God. Like, you'd kill a dove or you'd kill a goat. Not you personally, but the priest would, and you would offer up an animal. That was how you worshiped Yahweh. Isn't that strange? Now as we sing songs, we're actually offering up spiritual sacrifices. So you had this temple, you had this building, you had this structure in the city of Jerusalem. You would go up to the temple, you'd connect with the priest, you would sacrifice an animal. And that was how you worshiped Yahweh. And so you had all these priests. But over all the priests, you had the chief priest, or the high priest, and that was called the Kohen Gadol. And he was the supreme mediator between God and the nation of Israel. He was the priest of all the priests. He was the apex of the priesthood, and it was embodied in a single man. And what the Kohen Gadol would do is once a year, he would go into what was called the Holiest of Holies. And so Solomon's temple, it was the second temple. The temple had three sections. It had the outer court, it had the holy place, and it had the Holiest of Holies. And in the Holiest of Holies was the Ark of the Covenant. That's where God's presence was. And once a year, on Yom Kippur, or the Day of Atonement, the high priest would go into the Holiest of Holies. And when he went into the Holiest of Holies, he had like a special outfit that he wore. And part of that special outfit, he wore this breastplate that was made of gold. And on that breastplate were 12 stones representing the 12 tribes of Israel. And then he had these gold plates on his shoulders, and on those gold plates was also written the 12 tribes, the names of the 12 tribes of the nation of Israel. And what that represented was that the high priest carried the people of God in his heart and on his shoulders into the presence of God. That he represented the people of God before God, like a shepherd carrying a lamb. He was carrying the nation in before the presence of God. And he would go in, you know, with the sacrifice of a bull and of a ram to make atonement for the sins of the nation of Israel and to seek God's forgiveness for the nation of Israel. He was a mediator. He interceded for the nation of Israel, and then God would receive that and he would forgive the nation of Israel. Now, I mentioned this in the first service, and I texted Roth, but Roth doesn't always text me back, is that Roth may find this interesting, is that when the high priest would go into the Holiest of Holies, he would actually go in barefoot. So I don't know if you ever noticed this, but Roth leads worship with no shoes on. Can we just give Roth a round of applause? Now, I know he has some profound reason why he does that. He's never really explained it to me. But I'm so grateful for him. I'm like, hey, whatever, man. No shoes. And normally it's pretty good. Last Sunday, though, he had red socks on, which I thought was a little distracting. But anyway, so the high priest goes into the holiest of holies barefoot. But what the author of Hebrews wants to show us is that, you know, and if you think about it, if you were a Jewish person, like, think how, like, psychologically helpful that was to know that, hey, ultimately there's some guy that's going to go, like, sort things out with God for all of us. Amen? Like, the high priest was like, I've got my problems, but hey, that guy's rad, and he's like sorting it out for all the rest of us, okay? And so if you were a Jewish person, that was like a deeply psychologically comforting thing to know that there's this one, you know, really strong believer who's gonna go and he's gonna sort things out for everybody else. And so I might not be perfect, but he's pretty good, and he's gonna take care of it for all the rest of us, right? But what the author of Hebrews is showing us is that as Christians, we also have a high priest. His name is Jesus. And he's an even greater high priest than all the high priests of the old covenant. And this Jesus, he doesn't just go into the holiest of holies once a year for a few moments, but he's actually entered into heaven itself. That when Jesus ascended into heaven, he went into the very presence of God, of which the holiest of holies on earth was just an earthly copy of. So our high priest is superior because he hadn't just gone into the copy, he's actually gone into the original, and he's there in the presence of God forever, making him infinitely superior to any earthly priest. And also, he doesn't just go in once a year, he's entered into the presence of God forever. And not with the blood of animals, but with his own blood. And he's an eternal high priest. The high priest, you know, in the early years of the high priesthood, they would serve for the course of their lifetime. It was like being like a king, or like being like a member of the Supreme Court. Like you did it until you died, right? And so if you had a good high priest, it was fine. But maybe if, you know, he would be the high priest for 20 or 30 years, and then he'd die, and then you'd get random next guy. Maybe next guy wasn't as great as the first guy. Amen. And so if you had like good high priest, you're like, don't die. You know, then he dies, and then you get next guy's like not quite as good. Well, you know what? Jesus will never die. He's like the perfect king. He's like the perfect, flawless high priest, and he lives forever. And also, as the high priest, literally, this is literally what's happening right now. He's literally right now sitting at the right hand of the Father, interceding for us, praying for us, advocating for us. He's literally just leaning over and going, I know Mike frustrates you, but I died for him. Amen? I know he gets a little wound up and he talks fast and he has his flaws and stuff like that, but I love the guy. He's a good guy. And the Father's like, is he good? Yeah, he's good. Let him in. Okay, I'll let him in, you know? That's what he's doing. Like, that's literally what he's doing right now. Like, you have like an insider leaning up against God, like pulling strings for you and advocating for you and saying, he's a good guy. Let's let him in. And I know he'll drive you crazy a little bit, but don't worry about it. You know what I mean? That's what he's doing right now. He's at the right hand of the Father interceding for us. And so knowing all that about Jesus as the superior high priest, the author of Hebrews is saying, why would you ever want to go back to the old covenant? Why would you ever want to go back to that old system? Jesus is so much superior to that old system. Jesus is so much greater. He's greater than everything in this life. And that's true for all of us. Maybe this morning you're like, you know what? This is it. I'm just going to go back to my old way of life. There's nothing to go back to. I always think about when, you know, one time Jesus was teaching. And Jesus was like, he was so counterintuitive, right? So Jesus is like blowing up, you know, like 10, 20,000 people are coming out to see him preach. He's got this big mega church in Dallas. Everything's going good. And he's like, and then out of nowhere, he just says the most bizarre thing. He says, if you want to be my disciples, you have to eat my flesh and drink my blood. And it's like, womp, womp, womp. It's like even the worship team won't come up behind that. They're just like, nah, I don't know, man. And these are Jewish people, and the thought of like eating flesh and drinking blood was like their heads exploded. Like, that's paganism. Like, you don't do that. And Jesus doesn't explain it. He just says that, and then he's like, all right, God bless you guys. See you next Sunday. And it says, and after that day, it says that many left, and they never came back. And he didn't explain it. He didn't explain it to the crowd. And so then the apostles, they're like, Lord, can we grab lunch after church? And So they're all at Chipotle, and they're going, Jesus, like we love you, man, okay? Like, we're committed, all right? But what the heck are you talking about? And Jesus says, the words I say to you our spirit in their life. He's saying, you don't literally eat my flesh, you don't literally drink my blood. Is the thought is that you need to consume me, that you need to allow me into your life and allow me to become completely a part of who you are. And I bet all the apostles went, whoo. You know? But even before Jesus explains it to them, there's this great moment where Jesus, so a lot of people leave, and Jesus turns to his apostles, and he says, are you too going to leave? And I love it. He doesn't explain it to them. He says a super weird thing. Doesn't explain it to them, and he says, are you too going to leave? And Peter has the best line. He says, Lord, where else are we going to go? Because you alone have the words of eternal life. Amen. And every time I've ever thought about leaving Christianity, where else am I going to go? There's nowhere else to go. There's nothing better than Jesus. I remember when I was a young Christian, I was in my 20s, and I was a youth pastor, and I was, like, dating this girl. And can we be honest? Can we be real about this? Everyone's like, whoa. Everyone's like, I wasn't paying attention, but now I'm paying attention. You lost me with all the Cajon Goodall stuff. I know, okay. So dating this girl, right? And she loved me, and I didn't love her back, you know what I mean? And there was the moment when she's like, I love you. And I'm like, oh, that's awesome. Thank you so much for saying that. I'm not trying to be mean. I'm just trying to be honest, okay? Well, everything kind of took a downward spin after that, right? And I just remember feeling really conflicted because, like, I really loved her mom and dad. I was like, she's kind of cool, but her parents are amazing, and I get the whole package, and it's like, and maybe I can marry her because they'll be my in-laws, and all, you know, all this stuff, right? And I was like, that's literally what I was thinking as like a 26-year-old, right? And I'm like, well, can you marry somebody you don't love because mom and dad are awesome? I was like, I don't know, you know, I was like battling with it. Anyway, so she broke up with me, okay? Shocker, right? And all the ladies were like, good for her, you know? And so, but the moment someone breaks up with you, you're like, wait a minute, I do like that girl. What was I thinking, right? And then I got upset about it, right? And I remember like getting upset with the Lord. And here's what the Lord said to me. He like didn't comfort me. Didn't go, oh, you poor thing. He literally goes to me. He goes, well, what are you gonna do? What are you gonna do? You're gonna get mad at me and walk away? That's literally what he said to me. Like all snarky. I was like, well, you're snarky, Jesus. He's like, that's literally what he said. What are you gonna do? You're gonna walk away? Because I didn't give you what you wanted. Now you're gonna leave? And I was like, this isn't what I was expecting you to say. And no, and I thought about it, and I was like, no, Lord, where else am I going to go? Even though you didn't give me what I wanted in this particular instance, even though I don't understand this, Lord, there's nowhere else to go. You are my Lord, and I love you. And even when things don't make sense, I'm going to trust you, and I'm going to believe that you know what's best, and you have my best interest in mind, even when something doesn't make sense, you know? And that was what was true of these guys. And so that's, the author of Hebrews is saying the same thing. How could you go back to that empty, dead system? That spiritless system, that empty system, when Jesus is so superior and so much greater? I've even joked around at times, like, say if I, like, stopped following Jesus and I just went back and I was just, like, clubbing or whatever, I'd be the guy in the club going, hey, can I talk to you about Jesus? You're like, dude, just go back to church, man. Like, I'd be that guy, because he's so amazing, I wouldn't be able to stop talking about him, even if I was, you know, totally blowing it, all right? So the second thing is Jesus is both a divine and a human priest. Jesus is the Son of God. And what it means that Jesus is the Son of God is that Jesus shares the same divine essence as the Father. In the Nicene Creed, the Greek word is the Greek word homoousios. Just say homoousios. There you go. There's your big theological word for the day, okay? And homoousios means that Jesus is of the same substance and of the same essence of the Father in a way that we are not. Even though he was born to Mary and took upon himself a human nature. And this is the Christian doctrine of the incarnation, again, which I'll unpack in next Sunday's sermon. But it's the central miracle at the heart of Christianity. And I think it's the greatest miracle of Christianity. It's that Jesus, in some mysterious, divine, miraculous way that we don't understand, is 100% fully God and 100% fully man at the same time. That God descended into our world, became a human being, and Jesus never stopped being God, was fully man, and some divine mystery that we don't completely understand. And that is the central miracle at the heart of Christianity. And that's what separates Christianity from every other religion in the world. And I think it's the most important miracle because if Jesus wasn't fully God and fully man, then he couldn't have died on the cross for our sins, then his resurrection would have had any value. But it was the fact that he was God and man that gives the cross its power and gives the resurrection its meaning. And Jesus is also superior to the high priest because, you know, yeah, the high priests were awesome, but you know what? At the end of the day, they were a flawed human being just like you were. But Jesus is flawless and perfect. And here's the thing about leadership is that every single leader is flawed. Come on, can I get an amen? Amen. And you know what? Not only is every leader flawed, but you're flawed. Like, we're all flawed. But Jesus is the one person who isn't flawed. And that's why we put our eyes on Jesus and we follow Jesus, because he's the one Christian leader who will never disappoint us. He's the one Christian leader who's never going to show up on some blog somewhere because of something sketchy he did. He's the one perfect person. He's the flawless, perfect leader, and that makes him the perfect high priest. And thirdly, Jesus is a sympathetic high priest. I love what verse 15 says. Look at this verse. It says, "For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but one who in every respect has been tempted as we are, yet without sin." And then I love especially how the King James translates this. And if you can read it, read along with me. "For we do not have a high priest which cannot be touched with the feeling of our infirmities, but was in all points tempted like as we are, yet without sin." I love that. "Which cannot be touched with the feeling of our infirmities." And here's the thing too. Yeah, we're all flawed, and also, we all have weaknesses. We're all weak. And the wise thing in life is not to try to deny that you have weaknesses. And all the men in the room are like, "Well, I'm not weak." And it's your girlfriend's going, "Yes, you are." You know what I mean? It's like, it's not, the thing in life isn't to try to like ignore our weaknesses or deny our weaknesses or hide our weaknesses. Actually, the wise thing in life is to know exactly what your weaknesses are. To know what they are, to be able to identify them, to be able to articulate them, to see them clearly. Because then once you see them clearly, then you can begin to deal with them. Please hear me. It's not about having weaknesses. It's about knowing what your weaknesses are, being honest about them, and coming up with solutions to solve them. You know, if you're a company, right, in the business world, they talk about you staff your weakness, okay? And so, like, say you're a company and you're really good at producing some kind of product, but you're terrible at marketing. You don't just go, "Well, we're just terrible at marketing." It's like you hire a marketing director, amen? Or you hire a marketing firm to help you. Or you don't just try to, "We make awesome products and we kill it at marketing," when you really don't kill it at marketing. No, you just go, "We suck at marketing." So then we're gonna solve that problem by bringing in a marketing director or hiring a marketing firm. Do you see how that works? And our lives are the same way. If you have a weakness, it's okay if you have a weakness. Just know what it is and come up with a solution to be able to deal with it. You know, I've shared this story before. Maybe you remember me telling you, maybe you don't, is that for a while there, I went through this period of time where it was like after church, for years it was like this. I had this weakness where no matter how amazing church went, I would go home and I would always like crash emotionally every Sunday afternoon. And back when we used to set up and tear down, I would like super crash because it was just so intense. You know, I would drive this box truck in and we'd have to set church up and preach two sermons and minister to everybody and be spiritual and then turn around and drive back home. And then I would get home around 4 o'clock and I wouldn't leave my apartment for 2 days. Can I get an amen from anybody on that? I would just crash. And it just dawned on me one day. It's like, you know what, Mike, this is not a sustainable way to live, man. You are not going to be able to continue to pastor in New York in your 40s and 50s and 60s if you don't come up with a way to deal with this. This is not healthy, it's not appropriate, it's not sustainable. And so then what I did was, then I started coming up with strategies. I started going to bed earlier on Saturday night. I started having a devotion on Sunday morning, which I used to not do, and I don't know why I didn't do that. I started eating a high-protein breakfast. I started drinking more coffee. Can I get an amen on that? And then what I would do is then before I would go home, I would know that when I got home, I was going to kind of crash emotionally. So before I went home, I would go get another cup of coffee, I'd have some food. And then when I went home, I stopped having these like hardcore emotional crashes. And now I just go home and I watch NFL football, amen? And again, we're gonna pray that the Bills beat the Dallas Cowboys at 420 today. But do you see what that was? Like, I identified that weakness, and then I came up with a solution for it, and I solved that problem. And I have other weak areas of my life, and I've come up with strategies and able to help myself in the areas that I'm weak. But the good news of the gospel is that Jesus is able to sympathize with us in our weaknesses. Because Jesus also was human, and he also was tempted. That's what's so amazing about the Christian God, is when we worship the Christian God, when we pray to the Christian God, we're praying to a God who became human. And so because he became human, he knows exactly what it is like to be a human being. You know, to sympathize with somebody is to actually enter into their suffering with them, to feel what they're feeling. You know, just be perfectly honest, you know, my stepmother passed away about 2 weeks ago, you know, and my dad is devastated over it. But I don't emotionally go, well, sucks for you. You know, no, I enter in and I cry with my father. Like, my heart is broken with my dad. I sympathize with him. I enter into his pain. I enter into his suffering, and I feel what he feels. And that's what Jesus does. Jesus doesn't stand at an emotional distance from us, but he enters into our suffering with us. Come on, can I get an amen on that? How amazing is that? When your heart is broken, his heart is broken. Now, he might tough love you like he did when I was 26, but it doesn't mean he's not feeling what you're feeling. He cares about you. R. Kent Hughes, in his commentary on Hebrews, he wrote this. Look at this quote. Jesus, our high priest, has an unequaled capacity for sympathy. It goes far beyond the intellectual because it's truly experiential. Jesus not just imagined how we feel, he feels it. The word sympathize here means to share the experience of another, to sympathize through common experience. And I love this last sentence. Look at this last sentence. The most sensitive man who ever lived feels with us. What did Jesus say to Paul on the Damascus Road about Paul's persecution of the early Christians? He says, Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? Jesus enters into our suffering and he feels our suffering with us. I love what William Lane writes in his excellent commentary on Hebrews. I think I have a slide for this. Our high priest suffers together with the one who is being tested and brings active help. When the lash is falling on you, he rushes in so that it falls upon him as well. When you are tested when you are treated with contempt, he experiences the humiliation that you feel. When you are bruised, he feels the pain. He's able to feel our weaknesses with us. And you know what? Jesus experienced it all. Have you ever been rejected? Just Leo in the back. Well, you know what? Jesus was rejected by the religious leaders. Have you ever been misunderstood? Jesus' own family thought he was crazy. Have you ever been betrayed? Jesus was betrayed by Judas. Have you ever been frustrated? Jesus got frustrated. Have you ever been abandoned? Jesus was abandoned by his father on the cross. And I actually think that was the most painful part of the crucifixion, to be abandoned by the father. Have you ever been overwhelmed with stress and anxiety? Jesus was so overwhelmed by stress and anxiety and fear in the Garden of Gethsemane, the Bible says that he actually sweat drops of blood. And that's not just like the Bible being like hyperbolic. That's an actual medical phenomenon where people who are undergoing extreme stress, the capillaries underneath their skin will break and they'll literally sweat blood. That's how stressed out Jesus was. So when you're stressed out, when you're overwhelmed, when you're overcome with anxiety, Jesus knows exactly what you're feeling and he enters into your suffering with you. And Jesus was tempted in every way. He was tempted physically, emotionally, psychologically, relationally, sexually. You know, Jesus was a perfectly healthy, handsome, 30-year-old man with testosterone pumping through his body, okay? And he was a rock star surrounded by all these beautiful Jewish girls, and he was tempted in that way too. But he was the second Adam, and where the first Adam sinned and fell, Jesus never fell. But you might say, yeah, but Pastor Mike, you know, if he was perfect and never gave in to temptation, how can he really understand what I'm going through? Actually, Jesus understands temptation better than we do because he never gave in to it. He felt the weight and intensity of it more than any of us ever will because none of us usually lasts. You know, we'll go, oh, I'm suffering, and then you get in. He's like, Jesus withstood it. It was like a rock withstanding the full force of a hurricane, and yet he never capitulated. Look at this quote by C.S. Lewis, and I'm almost done, but look at this quote by C.S. Lewis. I have two slides for this. No man knows how bad he is till he has tried very hard to be good. Can I get an amen on that? A silly idea is current that good people do not know what temptation means. This is an obvious lie. Only those who try to resist temptation know how strong it is. After all, you find out the strength of the German army by fighting against it, not by giving in. You find out the strength of a wind by trying to walk against it, not by lying down. A man who gives in to temptation after 5 minutes simply does not know what it would have been like an hour later. That is why bad people, in one sense, know very little about badness. They've lived a sheltered life by always giving in. We never find out the strength of the evil impulse inside us until we try to fight it. And Christ, because he was the only man who never yielded to temptation, is the only man who knows to the full what temptation means. He's the only complete realist. You know who understands temptation better than any other human being that ever lived? It's Jesus Christ. And people say, Christians say, oh, the devil's after me. He's probably not after you, okay? If anything, it's like some C-level demon. Can I get an amen on that? He's hanging out with, he's hanging out with other people, okay? He's not hanging out with us, all right? It's the devil. Don't flatter yourself, okay? I don't want to break the news to you. It's probably not the devil, okay? We're not on his priority list, okay? But Jesus was tempted by the devil, okay? Zane Hodges, he was a Bible scholar, he says the same thing. He says, only one who fully resists temptation can know the extent of its force. Thus, the sinless one, Jesus, has a greater capacity for compassion than any sinner could have for a fellow sinner. And because Jesus became human, because God became human, this makes him the sympathetic God. And this makes the Christian God unique from every other God. And with all due respect, I don't mean any disrespect, Allah never became human. The God of modern Judaism never became human. That makes the Christian God unique and special and revolutionary and unlike any other God that's ever lived, as our God actually became human. And so there is a level of sympathy and empathy that the Christian God has for you that no other God will ever have for you. We don't worship a God that's untouched with the feeling of our infirmities, but who is tempted in every way and can sympathize with us 100%. Who would not want to draw near to that God? How superior is that God? I have one little Bible nerdy thing and then two conclusions. Can you guys hang with one little kind of tight Bible nerdy thing? In Reformed theology, you have this thing, it's called the creator-creation distinction, okay? And just follow me is that. And what it says is that God, in his essence, is completely different than human beings. He's so fundamentally different from human beings that there's actually an uncrossable chasm between God and man. God is infinite and uncreated. Humans are finite and created. And so we can't even conceptualize what it would be like to be infinite. We have no paradigm even for understanding what it would be like to be uncreated. Because we're humans. And so there's this ontological gap between us and God. There's like this unbridgeable chasm of knowability. There's a certain aspect of God that we cannot understand. And the human predicament in ourselves is that unless God chooses to cross that chasm and to make himself known, there's no way we can know God. You can't work your way up to God with philosophy or natural theology. You can't work your way up to God by your good works. God is so fundamentally different from us that unless that God chooses to cross that gap and reveal himself to us and to make himself known, we will never know that God. But the good news of Christianity is that that God has crossed that gap, and he has revealed himself, and he has made himself known. And in the incarnation, by Jesus being 100% fully God and 100% fully man, he actually bridges that unbridgeable chasm, and that creator-creation distinction collapses in Jesus. Isn't that beautiful? And so through Jesus, God understands what it's like to be human. And for us, through Jesus, we understand what it's like to be God. And so Jesus, with one hand, grabs God, and with the other hand, grabs us. And in himself, he creates a bridge between us and God, a bridge of knowability. And through what Jesus did, he reconciles us to God. We become united with God, and we enter into a relationship with God. Now, God will forever be God, and we'll forever be human. But we can now have a relationship with God and understand God through Jesus Christ, who bridges the creator-creation distinction. And so because Jesus has these three characteristics, because he's a superior high priest, because he's both a divine and a human high priest, because he's a sympathetic high priest, then the author of Hebrews gives us two applications here at the end. And Stuart, you can come up and start playing keys. First, we're to hold on to our faith. Whereas the great American rock band Journey would say, don't stop believing. That was pretty good, right? Amen? So, no. Don't stop believing, man. Because when we go through hard times, what's the temptation? The temptation is actually to begin to doubt our faith or to begin to walk away from Christianity or question the goodness of God or embrace deconstruction or, you know, go atheist or whatever once we go through a difficult time. And what the author of Hebrews is saying, when you go through difficult times, when you face something you don't understand, when life takes a turn that wasn't what you planned, look at Jesus. Put your eyes on the great high priest who suffered the most unimaginable pain and suffering so that you could be saved. And when you look at Jesus, he can sympathize and empathize with everything you're feeling because Jesus experienced all those exact same things at the same time. And so because Jesus is such an amazing high priest, don't let go of your faith. Hold on to Jesus. And because there's nothing better than Jesus, where else are you going to go? And secondly, we draw near to the throne of grace with confidence. And I want you to hear this concept. Through Jesus, the throne of God, and I want you to visualize this, so the throne of God, which is ultimately is the throne of judgment, and one day every single human being is going to have to stand before the throne of God and give account of himself to the Lord. Okay? Well, that's the throne of God. That's the throne of judgment. But through Jesus, the throne of God, the throne of judgment, has become the throne of grace. Jesus transforms the throne of God into the throne of grace. Through Jesus, Yahweh, the awesome God of Mount Sinai, becomes Abba. Through Jesus, that the King of the universe, the Almighty God, becomes our loving Dad in heaven. When we come to the throne of grace, we find mercy for our past failures, and we find grace for our present and future needs. And we can come before the throne of grace with boldness and confidence. You know, John F. Kennedy's little kids were famous for going right into the Oval Office and just hanging out with their dad. And there's actually these great photographs you can find where it's like JFK, he's sitting at his desk, he's talking to some world leader, and underneath his desk, his little kids are playing with like Tonka trucks. And those little kids felt perfectly comfortable running into the Oval Office, and they were allowed to run into the Oval Office. Why? Because yes, he was the President of the United States, but he was their loving father. And that's what Jesus has done for us. He's transformed the God of the universe into our loving Abba, our Father in heaven. And just like John F. Kennedy's kids can run right into the Oval Office, we can run right in before the throne of God. And sitting on that throne is not our judge. Sitting on that throne is our dad in heaven, our loving father who loves us and is sympathetic towards us and has compassion for us. And so the last place we should ever run from actually is the throne of God, because it's the throne of grace. And because of what Jesus has done, unlike the Kohen Gadol, the high priest, who could only go into the presence of God once a year. Now through Jesus, we can go into the presence of God anytime we want. 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, the presence of God is open and available to us. And I think as Christians, we need to take so much more advantage of that. One of my favorite verses, it's like one of my new life verses now, it's 1 Corinthians 16:11. Seek Yahweh and his strength. Read this last part. Seek his presence continually. Yeah, when we worship, we feel the manifest presence of God. But you know what? You can have the manifest presence of God in your apartment. You can have it in your car. You can have it when you're on the subway. You can seek God's presence continually. It doesn't have to be just a Sunday morning thing, you know, singing some awesome song that Stuart wrote or whatever. You can actually experience the presence of God anytime, anywhere. But the God of Jesus, the God of Christianity, is not a merciless God. He's not an emotionally distant God. He's the God of all sympathy. He's the sympathetic God. And when we suffer, he enters into our suffering. He suffers with us. And so what I want us to do today as we close, I want us to take communion. And we're going to close by singing two worship songs. The band, you guys can start coming back up. And what I want us to do this morning is we have a communion station available on the south side, one available on the north side. We have two forms of communion. If you're here for the first time, there's like a bowl with juice in it and some bread. Don't drink from the bowl. Amen? Just take the bread and dip it in the juice. We also have like the little like kind of COVID safe packets if you want to grab one of those. But what I want you to do this morning is as you hold those communion elements in your hand, as you hold the body of Jesus and you hold his blood, I want you to realize that because Jesus' body was broken and his blood was poured out, we can now come before the throne of God to receive mercy and grace in our time of need. That through what Jesus did, he has transformed the throne of God, the throne of judgment, into the throne of grace. And so whatever you need this morning, if you need mercy for your past, if you need grace for your present or the future, I want you to come boldly before the throne of grace this morning. I want you to run into the Oval Office, and I want you to say, Father, I love you so much. Thank you, Father. Please help me. And like the story of the prodigal son, he will run out to meet you. He'll throw his arms around you, and he'll help you. Let's all stand to our feet. Everybody stand up. But even before we take communion, there's one last thing I want to do is I want to pray. If you're here this morning and you've never surrendered your life to Jesus Christ, maybe you grew up going to church, maybe you know your girlfriend's brought you or your boyfriend's brought you, or you've just been kind of coming and checking it out for a little bit, I want to give you an opportunity this morning just to give your life to Jesus. And so what I want us to do is we're all going to pray this prayer out loud together. And if you pray this prayer for the first time this morning, please come see me or Solomon or one of the members of the ministry team who are going to be available in the back. And let us know you made that decision. We'll give you a free Bible. We're going to pray for you. But let's all pray this prayer out loud together. And if you're doing this for the first time, I want to welcome you in advance into the family of God. Just pray this with me. Just say, Father in heaven, in Jesus' name I pray. Jesus, I believe you died on the cross. I believe you rose from the dead. Come into my heart. Be my Lord and my Savior. I surrender my life to you now. Give me eternal life and forgive me for all my sins. In Jesus' name, amen. Come on, let's give Jesus a round of applause. Put our hands together for Jesus. So we're going to sing two songs and then we're going to head out. But during this first song, I want all of us to get out of our seats, go to the communion station, take whatever form of communion you feel the most comfortable with, hold those elements in your hands. And that's what I want you to think about is through his body and through his blood, the throne of God has become the throne of grace. And you can boldly come before God's presence, okay? All right, so let's sing to Jesus and then head out from your seats and go get the communion elements.
Messiah still in Power, yours is the glory. Sing, my beloved. entire name is yours. We thank you for the season that we're in, Lord. We thank you that you became a baby, that you dwelled among us, Lord, that you showed us how to do it. Not only did you show us how to do it, Lord, but you gave us the passageway to inherit the kingdom. Because of you, because of your blood, Yeshua, we thank you, Lord. If you haven't already, I ask that you would partake in the communion elements, that you would analyze yourself, that you would ask for forgiveness, that you would do it, that you would take the elements in remembrance of what he has done for us, what he's done for you. Singing right now, amen. So we can join in, we can have some fun with this last song. This is the last song we're singing together before Christmas, so let's give it our all, amen.
Our King is glorious, amen? And that's why we sing glory to the King.
sing glory, glory to the King. Shout it out. Oh, we sing glory, glory to the King. Oh, we sing glory, glory to the King. Let's sing that last verse one more time. Hail the heaven-born Prince of Peace. Hail the Son of Righteousness. Light and life to all he brings. Risen with healing in his wounds. Mild he lays his glory by. Born that man no more may die. Born to raise the sons of earth. Born to give them second birth. And
you get on to make stuff up. 1 and 4? 1 and 4. Find out what 1 and 4 is, get on that and make up your own songs, people. If you don't know, Stuart will teach you what 1 and 4 is. Oh man, Merry Christmas. Yeah, give Jesus a round of applause. Testimony, I used to hate Christmas. It was like all these people happy for no reason, it's fake. And then I got saved. And the glory, one of the glories of Christmas is that the light of Christ pierces through all the darkness, that even the secular world has